I'm Jenny Wani. I'm the MSU Extension Master Naturalist Program. MSU Master Naturalist and Kent County Parks have partnered 10 years doing Discover programs. This is our fourth year at Millennium Park at the Hanson Nature Trail. We have 13 stations narrated by docents on all different topics to find out how nature works and learn, and as well as just experience one of the jewels of Kent County Parks. Millennium Park is just amazing. I had no idea it's as big as Central Park. But this nature trail was donated, and we hope at some point to get signage and so people could maybe just walk the trails on their own and learn things as we go.
It's exposing the families and their kids to nature and opportunities to be with nature in the community and to learn about it. It can be very educational.
There is an opportunity for families to come out and visit the Hanson Nature Trail and learn about some of the history and lore of this area and different things about nature.
Welcome to Millennium Park, and if you've ever wondered where you're standing and what the place could have been like 1,000, 2,000 years ago, that's where we all begin with this station. The ancient peoples that were here, we call them the Hopewell Indian tribe. Of course, they didn't call themselves that, but that's the only thing we know them as. And we know that they built what we call mounds, or earthen structures where they held everything that was dear to them and their burial grounds.
If you're going to use any type of fertilizer, just use the minimal amount, and because any 1 pound of fertilizer that leaches into the water makes 500 pounds of algae bloom. And algae bloom is a real problem because it takes the oxygen out of the water, and the fish need that. Now we have the invasive species like a loosestrife that grows so thick that the fish can't find their way to the edge of in the shallows, and they need the shallows in order to be able to breed and lay their eggs. So you can see if they can't breathe over there and they can't find their way to it, it's going to also hurt the population.
And some of the microlife that lives in the water, and actually view some of them through these little magnifying cubes to see how active they are, and that's a sign of healthy water when you have little critters that are living in the water, and how important it is to have our streams and our ponds be clean. And be careful about using fertilizer on our lawns and so forth, because what can happen is you can get too much of a good thing, where you can get something called algae blooms that cover the entire surface of the pond because of the excess fertilizer that has been leaching into the pond or the water. And that what that does is actually take the oxygen away from all the aquatic plants and animals that need that.
And then here we have a lot of bird books here that people can look at if they want. This
is something people, oranges, Baltimore Orioles love oranges. It's also with grape jelly on it. And this is fat, suet, that birds like to eat. It gives them energy. What else here? Well, we've got a couple of scopes here set up for people to look.
Language has always been hard for me, so now I'm learning bird calls. So we have all these tapes. And I have these playing in my car instead of music, so that as I'm sitting, because it's very difficult to see birds sometimes, but you can hear them. Mm-hmm. And so now I have a general idea of what maybe I might be looking for, or if I'm never going to see it, at least what was out there.
On your fallen trees and leaves and vegetation, animals, when they die, if they were not decomposed, they would be so high you couldn't see over them. But then you get your decomposers, which your very first ones are like your predatory mites and your centipedes, ants, different beetles. And when they get done and die off, then you get into your secondary, which are like your springtails and your mold mites and soil flatworms. There's all kinds of worms and things in the soil. And your protozoa. And then you get into your bigger beetles. And you're different. I think these are probably microscopic. And then you get into your last group, which are your slugs, your pillworms, different mushrooms, white worms. And you can see the white worms and the mites compared to a nightcrawler. You can see the difference in the size of them. And your fungi and bacterias. There's your little white worm again. Mites, spider mites are very tiny. Your millipedes, your snails, earthworms, they all break down vegetation. And you can look at the log over there and you can see where they have been working on that.
So there's been a big push with the environment to plant more native plants in regards to your everyday common perennials to put in. The everyday common perennials that you put in, most insects and animals may not visit and may be basically a bad source of food. So with native plants have developed an evolutionary relationship with native insects, and that relationship is very tight. As in the biggest example, monarch butterflies. Monarch butterflies only want native, they want milkweeds. That's it.
These are plants that we do not want to have in Michigan. Instead of pure Michigan, these make us impure Michigan, okay? So we want to eliminate these. And you can see number one is garlic mustard, which I have an example of right here. This is garlic mustard. It's a white flower. These are two-year-old plants. It spreads like crazy. And it should be pulled. And when you take it out, you try to reach down and get the roots. Because if you don't get the roots will regenerate and you'll have a new plant. When you pull it out, you should dispose of it properly. And what I mean by that is put it in a black plastic bag, put it in your garbage, and have the trash hauler take it away. This is an invasive plant. It's number two on our list. It'll grow to be 20 feet wide, about 9 or 10 feet tall. It does have a red berry that the birds like, and it's spread by birds. We'll eat the berries, and then they will have the droppings from the plant. And you will see quite a bit of this as you walk through the trail. Multifloral rose, again, it's very invasive. It provides too much shelter. Plants can't get the sunlight that they need, or native plants. And it's something that you can trim out and prune out and get rid of it.
The trees give us shelter. They do shelter for critters and creatures. We build things with them. They provide food sometimes. So that part is easy, but we want the kids to understand that a native tree usually grows better.
Right, and also with native trees, if we had more native trees, there would be less allergies for those people that do suffer from allergies. And in our presentation, we do try and talk to the children and help them to identify our state tree, which is the white pine tree. And it runs true to identify a long-needled pine tree. To say that it's a white pine, there are 5 needles in a white pine bundle. And if you spell out the word white, it's 5 letters. So,
and the kids always relate to the acorns and to, sometimes we show them the lichen and they've never seen that before, so they seem to enjoy that a lot too.
Here we have a fen. A fen is fed by underground water and is full of calcium and magnesium carbonate, which means your water is more neutral or alkali, and it's usually dominated by grasses and reeds. Last week we have a bog. A bog is a peat accumulating mass on top of water, and how that gets there is all the stuff that falls into the water and decomposes comes back up to the top, because your water in a bog is very, very acidic. And there's a lot of functions to a wetland. It's fish and wildlife habitat. It's sediment control, water pollution control. There's also a lot of value to a wetland. It's for water supply, flood protection, food and fiber, erosion control. And over there she has some sphagnum moss, which is what is on top of a bog.
This bog looks, or this moss looks dry. However, really retains lots of water that it accumulates. It holds it, it filters it, and it helps prevent erosion.
This is our eastern screech owl. It's one of the more, it's one of the many common species of owl in Michigan. This is actually a full-grown owl. This is the second smallest species of owl in Michigan, the smallest being the saw-whit owl, which is just a little shorter. These guys are hunters. They hunt all kinds of small rodents or bugs or whatever they can catch, but unfortunately because of their size, they are actually hunted by larger owls. Great horned owls and sometimes even barred owls will eat these guys. Now this guy's had a bit of an unfortunate time of it. He was out hunting one night and he got hit by a car. It's a common problem, birds of prey. They see food and they go for it. They see it, they concentrate on it, and they fly down and try to grab it. And we drive and we don't look up in the air. Actually, some people don't realize that it isn't anyone's fault, so they won't tell anyone. Which is a pity because no one's going to get mad because you bumped into an owl in the road. It's no one's fault. So, if you ever find yourself in a situation where you've hit an owl and it's still an owl or any bird of prey and it's still alive, yes, call someone. They will find if someone can help. But this little guy, he lives at the nature center because when he got hit by a car, his eye doesn't work right anymore. He can't dilate it right anymore. So at night, he can't see as well as he should.
We have a Petoskey stone, two Petoskey stones. One has been a little bit, not polished, but treated somehow. And this is a pudding stone. A pudding stone is just a conglomerate of different stones. Petoskey stones have actually got fossils. It's a fossilized stone. A couple of books, that's what enticed me to bring the books, is because they show you what stones can be found where. And we have a book on Michigan stones, and we have a book on the whole nation as a whole, all stones. The sand has been very popular with the kids today. They just love to get their hands in there. And
for sure.
Keep the cats away from
them. Yeah, right.
So far we haven't had any.
No issues.
My grandpa has a cat, and he's been pooping for us for
And then we planted deep down a little surprise for the kids, a little salamander toy that's been hit this afternoon, so it raises a few eyebrows and gets a few chuckles.
This is the eastern gray tree frog. He's native to this area. He's an interesting guy because he's calling at night right now, and they always call because they want to mate. It's a breeding call. And he also has little suction pads on the end of his toes, so he could climb vertically if he would like to. This is a tiger salamander. Salamanders are a lot like frogs and toads. They go through the same metamorphosis. And some salamanders actually stay in the water their whole lives, but most of them graduate to being land dwelling. You only find salamanders under logs or piles of leaves.
We've got honeybees here today. Right here you can see the queen bee on display. She's got a green dot like you see on my hand. I paint her with a green dot. She's the mother of all the bees in this hive. Every bee you see here is one of her daughters. They are the worker bees. So we have underneath the brown capping, we have developing larva, brood, eggs, larva, and developing bees, or what we call brood. Up here is honey on display, capped with wax. That means it's the right moisture content to be harvested. On the other side of the hive, you can see more bees. We have pollen in cells. Pollen is used by the bees for their protein source. They feed it to the larva. And honey is used as their carbohydrate. We have frames like, how do they make a queen? People often wonder, and I tell them, the queen lays eggs. Any fertilized egg can become a worker bee, can become a queen bee. A fertilized egg would become a worker bee. But if they feed it a special diet, while it's a larva, then it grows large. They feed it royal jelly. It grows large and they make a cell, like a peanut shell shaped cell. And they usually make several of those. You can see all these are queen cells. First queen to emerge or climb out of its cell would sting the others to death in their cells. And so she's the reigning monarch. And then she would go out and mate high above the trees with the drone bees, come back to her hive and start laying eggs.
I enjoyed all of it. I really did. It's very informative and you can never learn enough.